In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Glory be to Jesus Christ. Glory forever. It's a season of joy. The music is trying to make us feel relaxed, and we laugh about spending our money. And so, what I have to do today is rather unpleasant, because I have to address a topic which is so necessary to fully understand the Feast of Christmas. And that topic that has to come, you'll see why, is in fact, it's sin. We cannot understand and I think appreciate the power of Christmas, the joy of the feast, or even want to come to church on the feast unless we first wrestle with the theme of sin. Now, it's true that it's a topic that we tend to avoid even personally. Who likes to go to a friend or a priest or a monk or a spiritual father and confess his or her sins? It's a painful thing to confront our sinfulness. But as you heard today in the wonderful readings, they're so perfect for the Sunday before Christmas. The angel appeared to Joseph, the righteous man, and gave him a command, because of course the father, adoptive father in this case, had to give the name to the child, and he said, you will name him Yeshua, right? Which in Hebrew means Yahweh delivers, Yahweh saves. Because he will rescue, he will save, he will deliver who his people, I guess not everyone, it's just thoughts to think of it upright, from their sins. And so, to understand what happens in Bethlehem, we have to hear that name. Maybe Yeshua, for the first time, because if you're anything like me, I've lived in this land for 20 years now, sometimes the name Jesus becomes annoying because we hear it too much. It's thrown around. You know, there's cultures in Africa where the name is sacred. I heard the story, I think it's a true story, of a missionary from where else in the United States going to rescue the Africans, to bring the light of the sometimes Americanized gospel, but insisting on American cultural features and saying, so what's him, and addressing him by his name often, using his name often. And that offended this man, who said, don't throw my name around like that. The name Yeshua, Jesus, it is a sacred name. It is the name of the Lord, not to be taken or borne in vain. So I think sometimes as we hear the name, let us enter into our own inner cave and hear what it means. The way the angel spoke it in a dream to Joseph. So today we stand, it's pretty clear from the readings, at the end of Old Testament times. And we have to be able to, spiritually, to bring ourselves back, you know, in what, two, four, before Christ, right? Right before the birth of the Lord, maybe even a week before the birth of the Lord, which is what we are. It's spiritually to contemplate what we are thinking about. We are remembering, we are reliving the entire story of mankind since Adam and Eve, the fall, the patriarchs, and we're entering into their spiritual yearning for someone who would come and finally conquer sin. Because no one ever conquered sin, ever conquered death before. And there was this constant hope. The sense of darkness was falling. It was more and more oppressive. There was more and more darkness before Christ came. The Jews had been dispersed many times, the temple destroyed, run by not the legitimate priests, the king was a half-Jew, the Romans were oppressing, there was no real voice until really the Baptist came. I mean, it was really, it was midnight. It was the dark, cold, bitter winter of the human race. And that's where we need to stand a little bit, willingly, to think about that. What would be our life, our spiritual life, our home, without the coming of Christ? I don't know how, in fact, the Old Testament people really lived spiritually. They had to look for Christ spiritually, but we have been given that. And we have to ponder that. So, among all the stories that we hear about in Hebrews, and by the way, you know, the sacred story in Hebrews chapter 11 ends with the Maccabees, those who refused to be delivered and were willing to be tortured to have a resurrection. That's the seven Maccabean martyrs. So it ends with the Maccabees. It's the entire spectrum. But one story came to my mind because of this exchange is the life of the great prophet Elijah. As if you recall, there was a widow who had this beloved child who died. And she said to Elijah, "What do you have against me, O man of God? You have come to bring my sin to remembrance and to cause the death of my son." I know this, we don't like people coming to bring our sins to remembrance. But if we are unable to do that, to contemplate our own history, the news, then we cannot embrace the light and the morning star of the birth of Jesus Christ. And so, today I feel a bit like the Grinch, you know. I don't think I will steal your Christmas. I think I want to really realize the piercing of light and the darkness that takes place when the Son of God comes to the light in that cave. And I really believe that joy only truly happens when it's in contrast with a what if. You know, the joy when the child, you know, comes intact, alive and well, when, you know, there was one what ifs during pregnancy and delivery. The joy is even greater. I think sometimes we need to sense that perhaps we've been given this valley of tears, that our joy one day will be so incredibly intense. I was driving back home to Fortuna last night. It was piercing cold, beautiful sky, and there was this sign of the temperature, in fact, in the clock, and it was a black sign with, you know, these LED green and red dots, and said that the light really shines against the darkness. And that is what this feast is about, which is why, you know, I thought about having the feast in the morning on Sunday, or having it in the darkness of almost midnight, and I thought, let's do the feast in the darkness, in the piercing cold, that light may truly shine for us. So to understand this feast, I encourage myself and you to read Hebrews again. Hebrews is just this wonderful text which brings us as spiritual Hebrews, which we are. I hope we grow up with the stories, we love the stories, and to come to behold Christ. And it says this, Hebrews 9. "But as it is, he," that is Jesus, "has appeared," that's Christmas, "once at the end of the age," that's the end of the age is when he's born. It's an amazing verse. "To do what? To remove sin by the sacrifice of himself." I skip verse 27, famous though, 27. "So Christ, having been offered once to bear the sins of many," not all, again, I have to notice that, "the sins of many, will appear a second time," second coming, "not to deal with sin, but to save those who wait eagerly for him," as we should now in this season have a sense of waiting and longing. Then in chapter 10, verse 4, "It is impossible for the blood of bulls and goats in the old system to take away sins. And so when Christ came into the world, he said, and that's from the Psalms, right? The Psalms, sacrifices and offerings you have not desired, but a body you have prepared for me. So when we stand a week before Christmas and we see mystically, I hope, the Theotokos who carries in our womb God with us, Emmanuel, that's the body being prepared in the womb of Mary. So it really is a Christmas verse in that sense, in the highest sense. And then, I think when we see Jesus born on Christmas, I think we should reflect on the true potential and value of every human life, which Jesus Christ fulfilled. It's possible, I know it's hard to believe, to live a glorious human life, sinless, really divine. He did that, and then we reflect on our own lives, or more comfortably, on the sin around us. I mean, think about the news, a level. I mean, we're 2,000 years after the birth of Jesus Christ, and in these biblical lands, right? Damascus, Syria, Aleppo, these ancient places, Beirut, and you name it, Jerusalem. The power of Christ hasn't yet fully shown, and it's our job to let that light shine, as the song says, you know, within us and to the world, which still desperately needs the Lord Jesus Christ. Because we are not living in the darkness. We have seen the light. It comes to us every year of our life to be renewed and increased. You know, we can't accept the idea, some of us are getting old, some of us aren't, but that we're going to end our life and the light of Christ will shine mystically, you know, in our hearts at Christmas, but with the same force, or even less force as we get older. It should be that every year we are more and more entering into the whole economy of salvation. And that we, you know, we overcome more and more the sin that besets us. And so today we have truly something that we need to prepare for. That we can't, and the week is going to be rough. Have you bought your gifts? Have you wrapped your gifts? Have you bought your food? Have you? You know, it may be a difficult week in some ways to find time to enter into the joy of Christmas and to really understand this message of peace, that we are reconciled with God. It's true peace with God in Christ Jesus, because He takes away our sins and lets us become truly holy again, day after day. One last thing before I finish. When I was reading Hebrews, what was striking to me, I never really kind of noticed, is the verse, it's 10 verse 7, when Jesus speaks, actually, in Hebrews, then I said, as Jesus speaking, see God, I have come to do your will, O God. And that is what Jesus came to do. And I believe that the only way to live, really, is to do the will of God, to seek the will of God, to live in the kingdom of the divine will, so to speak, to not just pray every day, as we should do, our Father, that thy will be done, but really want to wake up and say, today I will be like Jesus Christ, I will try, help me God, to do your holy will. And bring the light and the joy and the peace of the gospel to this world. To Him who saves us, who is the morning star, be the glory of Jesus Christ, God with us, and the Father and the Spirit, always, now and forever, and to the ages of ages. Amen. Glory be to Jesus Christ. Glory be to God.